very brief introduction about myself. Anand Bagmar, been in the testimony for about 19, 20 years now, doing various different aspects related with quality. I wouldn't just call it testing necessarily. And it's been very, very fascinating. And my list of things that I have done may be long, but it is fractions of what I really want to learn and do more. There's so much opportunity in quality, how much you can influence and learn and do. Twitter ID is there, you can handle my blog, the sense of testing is there, and I think most of us know each other over here, you know how to get in touch with me for further things. As Mayank very correctly said, I don't believe in Q&A at the end. That is good, we will have opportunity to interact more at the end. But any questions, thoughts you have, or something is not clear, if I'm moving too fast or too slow, feel free to just let me know and we can talk more about that as required. Right? The context is important as we speak. Having more discussions around the same is always better. Okay. So enough about me. You all have, I guess, woken up early on Saturday morning to come here. What do you expect from me? Speak up.
The expectations for entrepreneur scripting.
Best practices for automation framework scripting, that is one of the expectations. Unfortunately, there's no such thing like best practices. It's a myth. It's practices that work in a context makes it a best practice, or it's just something that you're trying out in that sense. But we'll talk about practices for sure. Hopefully some of these become best practices for you in your own context. Some of them may not work. Feel free to discard and move forward. Right? We'll do that. Scripting side, what do you mean by that?
So basically there is coding practices.
Okay. So we'll talk some of that for sure. The coding practices that will make it effective. Okay. Anything else?
Your framework in such a way that it can be used across applications and kind of shared manually for automation.
Okay. How to structure your framework in a way that it can be scaled, extended, maintained, shared across the organization as required, right? Okay. We'll be covering some aspects of that.
So actually, I have seen that so tests are important and we do that, but sometimes if we don't basically care or show that much care for the test code as well, it really goes out of that, and that can actually slow down the development as well.
So tests are good, but if you don't write it in the right way, it can actually slow down the team more than instead of helping the team move faster. We'll be talking about some aspects of that. Yes. Anything else?
Resiliency of the code.
Redundancy of code, very important aspect. We will be talking about that for sure.
There are various tools actually, but then please help me. There was time. Which tools we should prefer?
Sure. So tool selection, and there are many tools which help in writing code. But how can we use it effectively? How can we use patterns maybe effectively to write good code, write better tests, right? Okay, so I think in a nutshell, you are in the right place. You don't need to step out right away.
So we would like to know from you while taking the decisions, like whether to go for TDD, BDD, ATDD. So what should be the aspects?
Question is about, would like to know about when do we go for TDD, BDD, ATDD, or whatever the practices that might be there. And unfortunately, we will not be talking about that as part of the session, but we can have a follow-up conversation around it and see if we can tweak it or try to include some aspects of it along the way, but if not, we'll take it separately. Okay, so I think we are in the right place. We can move to the next thing. Before I start off, I really like to get a pulse of who is there in the room and what roles, profiles are really playing, right? So any managers in the room? I think Anand is going to be fitting in all the categories. But this Anand, not me. Yeah. But any managers? No. Okay. Who cares about managers? other than developers, testers, automation folks, I'm guessing almost everyone, right? Okay. Anyone not developer, tester, or anyone in automation here? That's a better. My keys, keys are in a different set. Okay. What tool sets do you typically use for automation?
Selenium.
Cucumber.
Okay. JUnit Mockito.
JUnit Mockito. Thank you. Because we are not just talking. I didn't say automation is UI automation or something, right? It could be automation of any sort. So thank you for mentioning that JUnit Mockito. Okay.
JMeter.
JMeter.
Testing.
Okay. Sorry.
Testing.
Testing. Okay. Good.
Gatling.
Okay.
QTP.
Okay, we need to talk about that. Enough about that one, right? No, it's a good tool in a specific context, I mean, nothing against it. Typically, how many automated tests do you have in your framework? Of course, it depends on the context of the product, how long the product has been going. But I want to hear some numbers.
So, if we talk scenario-wise, four scenarios.
Four scenarios for the, again, you're talking functional only, right?
Yeah,
functional. 500. Okay. So you said 1,000?
3,000.
3,000. 4,000.
4,000,
okay. The bidding is going up. Okay. Anyone else?
500.
500. Okay. Come on, give me some atrocious numbers. But that's fine. Okay. 4 is manageable, I think it's maintainable. Okay. 500, 1,000, 3,000, 4,000. How many of these tests pass consistently?
100 for sure.
Unit? These are units he's talking about.
Unit and integration.
Unit and integration. And here's where the difference really starts coming in, right? Okay. So we leave your 1,000 out of the picture right now.
80%.
We are still struggling to get it 100%. Okay. Do you have the same 20% of
failing every time, or it's... No. Mostly infraction, whenever we try to...
So you're blaming the infrastructure? Right?
No. We have to manage infrastructure issues as well also.
Sure.
We have to correct those, so we are responsible.
So you said 2,000 tests.
3,000 functional end-to-end.
3,000 functional end-to-end. 500 tests. How many pass consistently?
For me, it's like 70-80%.
70-80%.
But it's all actually the updates are coming into new tests in application.
Okay. So tests are failing because of application is getting updated. Clearly, a process practice problem where tests are not updated before the application changes. Okay. 4,000 tests. How many of them pass consistently?
So we have, there is a concept of first pass rate, and then there is an automation which picks up the field and reruns them.
Mm-hmm.
The best we have been able to achieve is somewhere 92%.
So after the first pass order is failing, automation would pick up the field test again, rerun them, and hopefully magic happens and some of them pass again, and still he is able to reach about 92% pass coverage. Now that itself is a risk of lag, which probably a separate conversation again. There is no such thing like an intermittent test failure or intermittent test pass. There is a reason why it fails.
Our architecture is such that it is microservices based, and there are those dependencies. To eliminate that false positive, I mean, we can always say that first pass rate is maybe 80%.
Okay.
So 20% is failing.
Hmm.
But we don't want to get into analysis of 20%. So that's where the reasons are.
Sure. I'm just saying there's an underlying reason which probably needs to be investigated more. Why did that 12% still fail in the first pass or not? Maybe it is deployment happening, which is a different aspect. But other than that, maybe there's some other issue.
Yeah, so
which
there are
is
various,
their wish case.
Various issues we
exactly.
are nailing them down.
Right. Okay. How many of you have heard that test automation code should be of production quality?
It has to be.
Okay. Has to be is
there is no option.
There is no option. But how many of you do really believe in it? How many of you believe it, but it doesn't really happen? Still some. And don't worry, I'm not going to pick on you. But unfortunately, that's a reality, right? That is a reality. And unfortunately, the reality, I'm generalizing it, forgive all the developers in the room, but especially when it comes to functional automation side of it, if developers are contributing to it, they will forget all the patterns, practices that they put into the production code when it comes to writing the functional tests, because you want to get it done quickly. And it will work for some point in time, and then again you get to that 50, 60, 70, 80, 90% whatever, right? The scale as it keeps growing up becomes a challenge. And, okay, so that's clear.
I think that mainly happens if test is kind of an afterthought. So, if you basically do test along with your development work, it's more likely that you'll end up with the right test. Because you are basically trying to get the feedback out of it while doing the development of the work.
Makes sense. A very good point. Typically a reason might be why tests might not be of good quality is because you're thinking of it as an afterthought. If it is part of your process is what I was referring to earlier, then maybe you would put in more thought to make sure it is passing consistently, because the development gets blocked if any test is failing. You'll not be able to proceed further from that point. Very good point. I don't think this really applies, but still I'll ask. Anyone who does not understand code here? I guess not. That's fine. Okay. A disclaimer. We spoke about best practices, right? It's in a context. The title of what we have in this session is Patterns of a Good Test Automation Theory. And the good is a disclaimer I want to talk about. It's very contextual again. Right? It depends on the context what that good really is. Our focus is of having the required qualities of a high standard, again fit for purpose kind of thing. Right? So this is not a golden rule or a golden bullet or what silver bullet, whatever you want to really call it. These are different approaches, practices that are there. And over the course of my experience, I've come to believe strongly in some of these which apply in general to most situations, which may not apply to many others as well. Okay. So just bear that in mind. Let's get into the core of the conversation. What is a pattern?
It's a waterfall. The artifacts.
Organizing the artifacts of the framework or organizing the code?
Yes. The way you organize or classify your code.
Okay. Code classification.
It's a technique to achieve something, a proven technique to achieve something.
To solve certain problems.
Proven technique to solve certain problems, and that actually comes the closest, right? It is a repeated, repetitive design that you can apply to something. If you observe the carpet, it's a repetitive design of one tile that is there which is spread across. You create one and you just keep on replicating, because you know that is going to fit for purpose in that particular context, right? That is what a pattern is. In terms of software engineering, it is a reusable solution to a problem of specific types. And it also makes it easy to communicate in that aspect once you know what you're talking about using that generalized term, right? So if you say the circular pattern for whatever reason, right? Everyone knows what a circle is. In the context, everyone would immediately be able to relate to what does that really mean without having to know about is this in Ujjayi's office or some other office or wherever else. Right? It becomes a very easy means of communication across different collaborators who are in the discussion. This book is really good. If you have not read it, you should read Design Patterns, and there are various other books as well related with that. Very, very important. Okay. So we are going to talk about patterns in test automation. Most of the conversation will be focused based on functional or view test side of things, but of course these are patterns for software which will be applicable in whichever context you really want to use, whether writing code for product or from a testing perspective. Okay? So, have you heard of any patterns or used any patterns for your test automation?
Page
object model. Functional testers talking, exactly. That is by far one of the most powerful and best pattern I agree.
Builder pattern.
Builder pattern. each other patterns.
What is builder pattern?
Sorry?
What is builder pattern?
We'll talk about some of these. Okay. Any other patterns?
We use singleton and factory players.
Factory and singleton pattern, yes. Does anyone know how many patterns are there actually? Too many. Okay. So the common patterns that we see is page object pattern that we have seen. Business there, which we'll spend a decent amount talking about this later on. Singleton is there, composition pattern, factory pattern, builder pattern, and there are many, many more patterns that are there. Our focus is not probably to talk exactly the specifics of a particular pattern. We'll focus on just a few of them, but we'll see how we can cover some more aspects out of that as well. Okay? So let's look into test automation framework patterns, and again, to make the concept clear, we are going to use a reference of a very old Amazon.in website, Amazon.com website actually. This is pretty old. Okay. Now, imagine if you had to do test automation, functional test automation for this, and the only objective given to you is write a test for this particular Amazon.com page. Okay. What is a typical approach you would have? You would start with your automation.
Identify the type.
Identify end-to-end flow. What else?
Functional wise, you can verify especially in Amazon web page. Basically verify the title.
Verify title. So again, identify the scenarios and that type, right? Yeah. What else? So that is one aspect, of course. If you don't know what you're doing, then what will you automate, right? So that's a prerequisite in certain ways. What else?
So thinking about the future, if we are going to incorporate the later pages, so as to take a decision whether to go for the page object model also, other can suppose.
Okay. So think about the future and accordingly start thinking about how will you automate in that sense, right? Yeah. If you need page object model or whatever else.
So basically try to understand the composition of this web page in terms of containers, how it is designed, what is the technology used, and what are different sections here. That
sure. So one thing which I tried to be explicit as well as subtle about is the only objective is to automate one scenario or something out of this home page, right? And that is one inherent risk that as engineers we run into, we start over engineering immediately. These are good questions or good thought processes, because if I don't know about the future, I might end up just going in the wrong direction, right? But I think you mentioned, right, that you'd start off by doing automating one test and start forward, right? Pick up a tool set, fit for purpose, and start off. And in my case, also that would be the first option, right? Or rather, the first step that I really take. Why? Because you have to prove a hypothesis that I can actually do automation for this product. So, the first example that we will look at, and now I'm going to keep turning back and forth every time, is this code sample is from a very different context. This is JavaScript code, no relevance to Amazon.com automation. But if I have to think about the first test that I have to write for a home page or any particular product, I would probably say, okay, if I know the tool set that I'm going to use, I know the product that I'm going to interact with, what is the bare minimum that I need to do to get that functionality test? Set up the tooling infrastructure in place, get the libraries, jars organized, whatever is there. I identify what is my test really going to be, instantiate the driver directly, this is a Selenium web driver example in JavaScript, and just do some actions that is all within one test itself. Because if that is what my objective is, do I really need to do anything else beyond that? Right? So the first step is just prove that the toolset works for the product under test. That's how it would start off. Of course, this is not where it ends. Okay? But now I know I've collaborated with the team and said, okay, you've built this page, this is what the test does. Does it make sense? Are we able to achieve the kind of validations, assertions that we need to have based on this? Is this good code? Definitely not. This is the first cut. Right? So with the first cut, then what we get is confidence that yes, you are able to now proceed to the next level of whatever that means. If I need to use a page object model or organize code better or whatever else needs to happen, right? The first step now you have taken care of. Okay? The next step would be now to actually start thinking, okay, I've proved my hypothesis. I know it's an Amazon.com page, right? But I now need to do more with it. Of course, there's not just one scenario about loading it and verifying the title. There's so much functionality over there. Now I've identified the different scenarios, I've prioritized them, what makes sense to be done at a UI level, functional level, and how will I go about doing it. Okay? So before we get more details into the implementation side of it, I know almost everyone would be familiar with page object pattern, but let's just recap quickly for those who might not before we move on to the next thing. So what is a page object pattern?
Concept is to design, or it is a design pattern that we create one class for page which holds all object repository for that page and the data setters or the basic methods.
Okay.
Yeah.
So basically it's one, so speaking from a coding perspective, it is one class per page that is there. It should have its object locators, identifiers, and actions that you need to do on those particular objects, whether get information or set information on them. And that's what a page would really be, right? Okay, that's good. What does that really mean, right? What we're really saying is we are now modeling whatever the page functionality is into test aspects, right? How will we interact with it? So model those pages as a feature implementation into code from a testing perspective.
This pattern provides an abstraction about the functionality of that page. We don't have to know what are the internals of that page are as far as we can call the certain method which are abstracted.
Sorry, I missed the last part.
I mean, if you can provide a better abstraction, you don't have to know the internal details of how the login button is found on that page or whatever is the ID of that page.
Okay, so
as an external user to that page object.
Exactly. So once the page object is created, I'm just going to rephrase it in a certain way so you can correct me if I missed out some points of yours as well. Right? So you would model the functionality of the page in code in terms of, I don't need to know the internals of how the page is implemented, the feature is implemented, but just by the methods provided by the page, I'll be able to interact and do actions on them. So it provides an abstraction level from implementation details to interaction details around it. Does that sort of sound? Yeah?
Even in terms of debugging, if there's a failure in a particular page, I know where I have to refer. I need not.
Exactly. So this is the advantage of page object model, that if it fails, you know, looking at the failure, you should be able to look at exactly where the problem is and not have to spend a long time doing root cause analysis for that. I have a counter example for that, but I'll hold on to that. We'll come to that later. Okay? So we spoke about this, right? It simulates the user actions, the interactions with that particular functionality itself to make sure you can accomplish the validations what you're trying to simulate the end user would be interacting with your product, okay? And because of what you just mentioned, right, about if there's a failure, you know where to find the problem, it also means it's a one-place change. If a login functionality has changed, but the login being a critical aspect of almost all the scenarios that we have, you don't want to go and make changes all over your test just because login functionality has changed. If you have abstracted that well enough in a login page functionality, then you will be able to just make change in that one place. And in most cases, everywhere else, it would work fine. I'm saying most cases because it still depends on how, what is the impact of that change on other functionalities as well. Right? So that is a context to keep in mind. As a result, it also reduces the code duplication, right? Because it's all in one place. You don't have to keep on repeating that information or implementation all across. A very important aspect of this page object model is that when it comes to thinking about snippets of page. Okay? Now, Do we understand what snippets of page means?
Replication of page in terms of code?
No, replication of page in terms of code, no, that's not what snippets of page means. Before I show you the example itself, let me ask you a question. Will a page object model work for Amazon.com type of scenario? Amazon.com type of product, so I'm not saying.
Yes,
it might. Yes, because there are logical pages, right? You know there's a home page, shopping cart page, whatever, product pages of different types, whatever. There are logical pages that you definitely can directly see in the product as you're interacting with it. What about single page applications? No necessity of having a page object model in single page applications. Can you give me some reference of single page applications?
Netflix.
Netflix?
Gmail.
Okay, let's take the Gmail if not everyone has used Netflix, right? I don't even need to open the browser in that case. Everyone has used Gmail, right? Single page application. How many test scenarios do you think at top of your head, minimum number of test scenarios, functional perspective, would you have in Gmail type of product?
Definitely 100
plus.
Definitely.
100 plus? Okay. Are these going to be trivial tests? Yes. They are trivial tests in terms of complexity, in terms of implementation, or are they going to be much more complex? Complex, right? Why? Because it's not just about whatever I see in that Gmail, is it there? It's also going to be about, I'm sending an email to Anand, is Anand receiving an email from Anand? Right? There are many more things that are there, so much complexity is there. Will you put everything in one page object? Or rather, no page object, so how would you organize this code?
We'll definitely have to think about some design other than page
object. Okay. And that's what I really mean by snippets of page, right? And let's see some example, and we'll tie it back to this Gmail example, how it potentially works. So coming back to our Amazon.com page, how many snippets of pages, or rather how many pages, just looking at it from here, this screenshot, do you think are there?
Okay.
Name the page objects.
Search.
Menu, search.
There's a my account feature.
Hero image.
My account, hero image.
Card.
Card.
Recent items.
Recent items.
Yeah,
footer.
Ads. Featured items.
Ads. Featured items. Okay.
Get a quote.
Sorry?
Quote message.
Get a quote. Exactly. Well, you don't have a page for that because that's an ad inserted, but you need something to handle ads in your page as well. Are the ads, if I have configured it to show ads, are they really coming up or not? So there definitely needs to be something different for where the ad needs to be and is there an ad or not doing actions on that, right? So that would be there. So clearly it's not 5 or 7, it's probably more than 20 if I just look at it from this aspect. Let's try to see. Search. Is that one page?
No, it's a snippet of
a snippet of a page essentially is still a page, right? And this is where composition pattern starts coming together. You're composing different page objects together to form one home page. Or in this case, search being part of the menu potentially is part of the menu bar page, which is part of the home page and other pages as well. Right? But is search itself a single page?
Can be,
and I don't know as well. Why is it?
Because the effect of the actions on the of the search will change the rest of the behavior of the application. So you won't be able to test it in a single context if you want to.
But that is different, right? The behavior, the implication of actions done on any page, whether it's a clicking on this or doing something else, the result of that action is going to be maybe another page shown up or something else that needs to happen. That is different. The question is modeling the search functionality itself. Is that one page?
Yes. It is reusable in this.
Okay. Are you sure about that?
Yeah. If the search is replicating on all the pages,
So search is definitely an independent page. The question is it just one page or is, does it need to be multiple pages?
It
needs
to be one page.
So you see this all over here, right? It's a drop down. Do we know what is inside the drop down? There is a much more bigger expansion under search what you can do. So again, depending on the scenarios that you come up with, what are you trying to test? It might be in one page, or if it is getting too complex, you might want to separate it into multiple pages depending on search, basic search or advanced search. It all comes down to the type of scenarios you are in and what you need to do. So as a first cut, if you just have to test based on search, maybe one page is sufficient. Right? The menu bar itself. Is that menu bar one page? Menu bar is one page, there's just one menu bar. It is composed of many different pages over there. Okay? Sorry, I'm not trying to confuse you, I'm just trying to give you different perspectives. I'm going to keep saying opposite of what you say in most cases. Because the answer is not just one straight answer.
I think menu bar is more like a segment which you can have it across all the pages.
Now, segment becomes a completely different concept. What is a segment in context of a web page or something? So to keep it simple, if I just say it's a menu bar page, if you have to do root cause analysis, right? My test failed in menu bar segment. Now, what is a menu bar segment versus a menu bar page? Okay? As long as the team agrees to the terminology, you can call it anything you want. That does not matter. There has to be consistency in the way you use it, because again, that's where patterns, we said, right? It's a repeated design. If you speak in a way that your colleagues, team members, whoever you're talking to knows what you mean, great. If not, it's better to use that common language again to avoid confusion. Okay? So the menu bar can potentially be one page itself, but it will either have a basic search page or an advanced search page, depending on the context if it is expanded or not. Because even if all is expanded in search, now you see advanced search over there. That is still part of the menu bar, it's not part of something else. Right? We spoke about the ads. If there are ads possible to be shown in the menu bar, that comes up over there. But there are also ads over here in different aspects. Maybe it's internal ads, external promoted items, whatever, right? And we spoke about hero images, related items, the sign in, your account. Is that one page?
Yes, composed of.
Again, composed of many others, right? So again, this becomes an evolution of what you do. You would start off saying that, okay, I'm going to create an account page if I want to sign in. How? That account page is going to be part of my menu bar. I'll go to there, I'll click on sign in, I'll sign in, I'm done. But now if I need to do something more with that, then maybe I have to think about your cloud drive.
Is that really part of my account page?
This is assuming this is functionality inside the page and not a link taking you outside the context, right? But does that really need to be part of my account page or does that need to be something else? Where does it truly belong? So you have to start thinking accordingly. You have to keep on breaking up the pages, composing pages based on as your scope keeps on increasing. Okay? And likewise, we spoke about these other items that are there. And there are many more over here. Now that you know page object, you know the snippets of pages that are there. And this is what I call snippets, right? Because independently, menu bar is not a page, it's a snippet. It's a section which is used, which was created as a section because it has a lot of complexity. It might be used just in one place itself for that matter, right? The hero image, for example. It might be used only on the home page, but if it is complex enough, it is better to break that complexity into a separate page so you can manage it better. So in this case, it's a page going to be used only by the home page. However, the menu bar is a snippet of a page which is going to be used across any page in the product lifecycle. Okay? So again, that context is important. Doesn't mean you break up functionality into smaller pages only if it is going to be reused or not. It is always based on the complexity side of it. Okay? Now based on this thought process, coming back to single page applications. Gmail. How would you model? Can you model Gmail type of a product in a page object pattern? How?
in a similar fashion.
Similar fashion. Take functionality.
Can we break it down? Okay.
So from a functional automation perspective at least, page object model becomes a very logical way of thinking about how you are going to break down your product into smaller pieces that make it more manageable to interact with. Okay? Anyone wants a mobile application to it?
Or a POC?
POC. Okay. Do you think similar thing can be used for mobile apps as well?
Yes.
Not talking about web, talking about native apps.
Yes.
Why not?
Hybrid.
Your native app, not hybrid. Hybrid means you have gone to a browser.
Right.
It's exactly the same concept. There's no difference. Only thing that I would probably call it different is instead of calling it pages, we'll call it screens, because in the native app space, everything is a screen. Again, just a nomenclature, no difference. How are you interacting with that piece of code, that piece of functionality? Can you logically refer to it in the same fashion and proceed? All comes down to that. Now, other than page object model, is there any other way that you can model this? Yes. How?
I mean, in the older days, there was like a keyword driven framework. It is just a way of thinking like what you are trying to achieve, you can have your own libraries. So, I mean.
But keyword driven is, I think, different from this context, right? Keyword driven or BDD or anything is just a way to say what your intent is, what you want to get accomplished. What we are talking about really is how that implementation will be done from a coding perspective, right? So, the entry point can still be keyword driven or BDD or regular JUnit test, whatever it might be the case. But how are you organizing and interacting with your product? Other than page object model, is there any other? And there are, right? I think QTP is a classic example. I think it uses a model-based framework or something like that, right? There are various other techniques as well, and no right or wrong. Depends on if you identify the right scenarios to be automated. And based on the skills, capabilities of the team, have you organized the code in a way that is going to be easy to maintain, easy to scale, easy to investigate if there's a problem, and update. Eventually, it has to be make changes in one place so that I don't have to change the same thing in five different places. That is what the objective is. Okay?
And that's where the object aspect of page object model plays a big role, because then you tend to think about object orientation, and these pages then speak for themselves in terms of what features they are giving to the
whole framework. Absolutely.
And then those concepts, like whether it is an advanced search or it is a basic search, you can then start building in that using the object orientation, where inheritance will come into picture, the way how the composition will fall into picture, and then your modularity, maintainability, increases drastically.
Yeah.
So I like the object part of it the most.
Absolutely. Yeah. So I'll just quickly try and rephrase. I think it was just a comment on the name object in the page object model actually signifies a lot, especially to the engineering folks, right? You know what an object really means. How do you interact with an object? What capabilities are there in an object? And you inherently tie it with a programming concept what an object really means. Can it be inherited or whatever else comes across that, right? No, and then patterns also naturally fit or extend as part of that as well. So the name makes a big difference. Probably if it was a segment, it would not have resonated as much.
It's very powerful. I think the object orientation aspect is very
important. Absolutely. Okay. So now we understand what the snippets mean, right? You want to reduce the duplication, you want to reduce the complexity. And we'll talk about the complexity also in another good example. Purposely, I have taken code examples of various different programming languages. These are what I have seen from real experiences. In various ways, I have contributed to these as well. I will not say the bad parts where I have contributed to that one. But these are real world examples. So now, we start thinking about So if it was a classic case of one page everything, home page, look at this file, almost a 1000-line file, and this is in Ruby. If the same thing had to be done in Java, probably at least 5 times. At least 5, right?
Yeah.
If I have to put every functionality in one page in terms of the interactions with it without thinking about breaking down the composition aspects, I'm going to have this kind of a mess. And why do I call it a mess? If there are 3 QAs or 3 engineers working on writing tests, the way Anand is thinking about calling a method, login now, what I'll say, login underscore now, whatever it might be, not just naming conventions, right? The way I'm thinking about that functionality, I might say, there are 100 methods in this class. I don't know if the one that I want is there or not. Let me just write another one. It's so easy to happen because I have to keep moving forward as well. If there's a problem, if the implementation is there now in 2 places, there's nothing wrong, nothing stopping you from doing that. But one test will pass, one will fail. Not know what is going on. Right? So just simple understanding of the code, working with it, extending it, itself becomes a huge challenge. Right? And as a result then, you naturally start breaking it up into smaller tests. So this will be one, and then your test would start having it, right? The other aspect of this will become, if this is a test, now I have to start calling those hundreds of methods from my test implementation perspective. Again, the test verbosity grows significantly. Just looking at the test, no one might even know what the intent of this query is. Of the 3000 tests that you have, out of which 80% pass, out of those 80%, how confident are you or the team about knowing exactly what the test is doing? It's an obvious answer, right? It takes time to build so many tests. As humans, we cannot remember each and every detail. But what we say, as long as it is passing, not another question. Because it will start feeling great. Obvious thing, right? So, this becomes one example of how the evolution starts, right? You start building, and what I would do typically is, I had that first method, the first code that I showed. Now, I know I need to do more. So now I start abstracting things out into driver utilities or whatever. How am I going to manage instantiating of the browser driver or whatever else that is there? And I start breaking that. But the next logical thing is, from a page complexity perspective as well, eventually you need to start breaking it up and make it more manageable. And that is where you get to a better implementation in terms of saying, okay, in this case I'm calling it partials, right? In some cases, it is just one method over there, which is fine. There is no penalty per se in just creating more classes. It's not just redirecting. Instantiating those objects, classes or objects is not going to be a big penalty, but it makes the management of that code much more easier. You know exactly what is happening. In some cases, there is a lot. In some cases, there is little. In some cases, there is more than. Okay, and it's okay. As long as it is logically belonging in that particular class is what we need to think. The minute logic starts getting diluted or there's too much information happening over there, you need to start breaking it up. Okay? And then of course, the code organization, what we spoke about earlier, right? This becomes a very natural part, extension into what code organization makes sense. There is no specific technique what you should use in organizing your code. Over here, in some cases I'm calling it partials, in some cases I'm calling it search, which is more functionality driven. Partials might be something which are used across multiple types of components or features. It depends on the team again, how do you understand breaking down that product into logical chunks. No right or wrong. The goal is one place change is required to update that functionality as the product evolves. Okay, there is another aspect which I really want to bring out over here. Taking this as an example, I think this is the right example. Yeah. Is this a good code? I'm going to skip this first part.
Why is it a problem?
We are grading the objects as well as working on those. So we can still segregate those sections.
We can still
put those sections in some other methods.
So can you give me an example?
We can refactor. We can refactor.
So can you give me an example based on what you are saying?
So like get.
I'll just let her finish.
Get filtrates and then find element by ID and clear, send key, all that.
So over here we are saying this is a method, but over here you are interacting directly with the locator. Is that what you are saying?
Yeah.
That's the refactor you are saying to
deform.
So you're saying it's just a matter of clean code, you need to create methods for this.
That is one thing.
Sorry, you add some thoughts.
So if I have to look at it critically, I would say it is asserting things here which I feel slightly odd, because I would want anything to just obey what is being done, and the assertion should be done at the test level. Because the test only knows.
Sorry, I was not clear. This is a test. This is a generative test.
Okay.
So, maybe this is a test.
Then, probably the code is too much.
Okay. I'm just creating a parking lot. These are some other items that I would like to talk about given time. Yeah,
probably, as you said, we actually should and can break down it under different methods. For example, in this case, it is basically asserting whether it's on a patent page or not, and the patent first name is basically enabled. So you can actually break that into different methods, and the effect of that is actually twofold. One is, now I don't need to understand that particular piece of code unless I'm actually working on it. And I can just read it like, are you on this particular page or are you on the patient page? So I don't need to understand that. At the same time, you have a smaller component to manage. And if it basically makes it happen that there is something like that component, and then you have an opportunity to actually move it around to manage. Better
into
the structure of the
code. So one aspect is about the assertions. What type of assertion should it be in the test itself, or as different methods which can be reused across different tests as well, right?
We are not validating what we are getting. Like if I am getting null in a patient ID or some other value, right, sure, which is not expected.
Sure, that's validation of what return values you are getting, that is not being null over here. These are, I think, still problems that are in more developed countries. The developing countries' problems are still different. I'll put it over there in that context. Okay? And I'll tell you why. The minute I put interaction with elements, locators directly, that is a problem. Why? Because I already have some pages clearly. Why don't I have this in a page as well? Is this supposed to be in that page itself? Or some other page? Why have I not created that page? And because of that, the problem is, if it is supposed to be, let's say, in registration page for whatever reason, right? In registration page, the locator changes, I go and update the page, but my test is still going to fail because this locator has not changed. It's not a one place change.
So you have to update it everywhere.
You have to update it everywhere. And if this same basic thing is then in 10 different tests, you have to update it in 10 different tests. Okay? These are the true problems of how you start building it.
You have to delegate your access
exactly
to the page.
Exactly. Right? So, some rules of thumbs that you need to have, right? What developers would very strongly have in the product. Naming conventions, what type of unit tests to have, what frameworks to use, how are we going to create mocks or not. There will be standard ways that the team comes up with saying, how are we going to do it. Likewise, it is required over here. And there is nothing stopping in that sense from doing this aspect. Because I can get access to the driver object and on driver find element by ID and I can proceed with this. But how are we going to impose practices to say this is not the right thing to do? Because it will work for 5 tests. The minute it gets to 100 tests, it is going to start failing. Not even getting up to 1000 or 3000. Okay? And these are hygiene issues
to say we are not going to tolerate when writing this. It's like saying before eating, I'm going to wash my hands. It is those types of severe issues that I have. Okay? There's another example which I hope I have in this one. Okay. Let's take this example. For a minute, ignore the aspect that this is driver.get.findElementByer and think that this is actually you are doing a method on the page object itself. Okay? Just do that mental rejection placement in your mind that this is on the register page, patient page. I'm saying register patient page dot enter patient address line 1 and this value. Register patient page, enter first clear and then enter. Likewise for line 2, first name, last name, right? So we are doing these operations on the pages itself. Clear with that mental map that you are doing? Do you see a problem with this approach?
Yes.
What is the problem?
Too many actions, so you are actually losing out flow of your actual test case, what you are supposed to use. You can easily club these and put it in a one method, which will, like, for example, valid registration, invalid registration. You are putting data directly into the test. You can very well take it from outside of the data.
Very good. So that is one very critical aspect out of this. Were you saying something else?
Yeah, I mean, same things. Basically, your modeling is not reflecting what business action you are talking about.
Exactly, right? More specific to what you said.
Yeah.
Very appropriate, very right things. I think earlier you mentioned, right, about getters, setters, locators and getters, setters on the pages. I think getters, setters and correct, all the developers in the room, correct me if I'm wrong, getters, setters are one of the most horrible things to have in your objects. Because it is not giving any meaningful information, it doesn't control any information or rules around what you're trying to do. And as a result, that becomes very powerful. Because now you can say, if I have selected country as India, then I need to wait for my state list to populate before proceeding selecting the state. I don't have to create that condition over here. Enter India, wait for state to be populated, and then enter state.
It's typically called tell, don't ask. So you don't ask your registration, you tell your registration page to fill up the details.
And as a result, again, if this functionality for whatever reason changes, you don't have to change all the tests where you are implementing that logic, enter country, wait for state list to be populated and then enter state. If this functionality is changing, the registration page, this method, will take care of what logic change needs to happen and everything still continues to work well. Okay? That becomes very, very important of how you build your test. The second aspect, what you very correctly articulated, is that with all this granularity, you also said the same thing, right? The intent of the test is getting lost, what you're trying to do. The focus becomes, am I entering the right test? The right details over there. Anyone reading it will not know what is this test really trying to accomplish. Okay? So very important to think about those aspects. So, with experience, again, of having learned the right and wrong way quite a few times, there's sort of a template that has come up in my mind what type of architecture a test automation framework needs to have at a very high level. And it doesn't matter about what tools I'm using, what toolsets, tech stack I'm using, but at a high level, I think this is what I strongly believe should happen. We've got a test intent, which is a JUnit test or a BDD scenario that might be there. That is where domain functionality actions, verifications, rules come up, right? register patient and whatever else has happened, you're specifying your intent. The way the implementation of that will happen, I need to know what a patient is. So that's a model in my system, right? What type of data am I going to have for that, creating a patient over there, and other aspects out of this. So you call it entities, call it models, doesn't really matter. Maybe you need to have some resources. I'm going to load data from some other external resources, whether it's database or files or whatever, or in test itself. We'll talk about that also separately. But then the actual implementation of that intent is going to happen via pages, doing action on the pages to proceed with. Now the pages itself are going to take help from helpers and utilities, loggers, resource handlers. Resource handlers as a means to use these resources, right? Custom reporters maybe, standard or custom, doesn't matter. If there is web service components, there will be separate web service utilities. If there is DB, there might be DB utilities. Whatever those kind of things might be as helper functions to get the implementation done. Again, you are not mixing things up from page implementation versus what the framework implementation needs to be for it. You're separating those up. Okay? The other aspect which is definitely going to be required is how is the page really going to interact with your end product? If it's a browser, I might directly use WebDriver. Or if it's web services, I might directly call some web service API library to implement that, or HTML unit, or whatever else. In various cases, good frameworks will actually have an abstraction layer on top of this as well. And depending on the context of how I'm running the test, I need to create a patient using the API instead of the UI, and this will figure out, oh, register a patient. Wait a minute, am I supposed to use the API or the browser? If it's API, call this utility to create. Right? So it becomes a very natural evolution, and this almost fits into any context that you can really think about. But this is a very high level schema per se, right? You have to figure out what exact those pieces are and how do you implement.
The resources also will cater to the test data. I mean, is it what you mean?
These resources are twofold. One is test data, and the second is environment based as well. Which environment am I running that test? Because based on which the data might be different, and of course the test data itself.
And where is the orchestration between pages is taken care of?
Test intent, domain functionality, evaluation. So that's a JUnit test typically, right? I'll create a patient, then I'll register or admit the patient and whatever else, right?
So that can also be layered, right?
Layered in terms of?
I mean, let's say if I want to introduce a layer which does give me like a business context which fall across multiple pages.
You're getting into the next panel.
Okay.
You're right. You're thinking in the right direction. We'll get into that. Okay. No one hear what he says. We'll get into that. Okay? Any questions on this one so far? So, do you think there are any limitations of page after panels? You know the value it brings to the teams. If done right, especially. We spoke a lot about that aspect. Is there any limitation of this?
If your pages are full complex, then you have to be building page object because those objects and might play up. Like we usually implement page object to help us debug things quickly, but it would not serve your intent.
So the comment is that if the pages themselves, page objects becomes too complex, and it becomes difficult to maintain, scale, or fix issues as you find that, right? I don't think that's a limitation of page object. It's a,
no, that's not
it's a different
limitation.
But you're right.
That's the problem we have faced.
So, as a what is the solution to that one?
Snippets.
Be very proactive about refactoring code, breaking it down as required. And that has to become part of every test that you are writing or fixing. It's not just I'm going to fix this test or I'm going to write a new test. As a result of doing this action, is there anything that needs to evolve in the framework? That is very, very essential. How many times do we get time to update our test frameworks or work on core framework activities? No one gets it. How many times do devs get time to do refactoring of major modules before they become new functionality? Almost every time, because business functionality depends on that change. If Anand as a developer says that if I don't change this core aspect of the product, I'll not be able to support this business feature. Of course, don't do anything, let's focus on getting that.
That's a bit.
No, so either you patch it till the level is possible. Either you patch it till it breaks, or in some cases, unless you make some changes or build some supporting infrastructure to implement new features, you'll not be able to proceed. Exactly, and that's the point I'm getting to, right? Why? Because it is business impacting directly. The minute business gets to know that, okay, there is a workaround, oh, forget about that, we'll find use this workaround right now. Right? But for test frameworks, we'll add 5 more QS to manually test it and we'll get this out.
We'll ignore the test.
Or we'll ignore the test, even worse.
So, interestingly, last 1 year, around 20% of investment was on the framework.
Excellent. And I would love to hear more examples of that, right? Because the value that the framework gives to the team to move forward faster has to be made visible in that fashion and make it happen. It's very essential to find time to do that. And that's the reason I say whether you have to refactor or change things in your framework or do whatever else related to the framework. As part of writing tests, you have to account for those activities, whatever impact you might require to make this test faster, because that becomes part of the process. Likewise, before you add 3000 and first test, if the team gets into a practice of saying, let me see which 5 tests I can delete first, because it doesn't add value or there's duplication for whatever reasons, and then I will add a new test, effectively you have removed 4, not 5. Right? This needs to become a practice in the way we are working, to say I'm not just going to blindly add tests in the framework just because it is automated. What needs to be removed because it's not adding enough value, get rid of it. What can be updated to extend value, let's do that. And then think about, do I still need to add a new test? That becomes a very natural.
Can I give an example? Why we invested that much?
Yeah, please.
So, interestingly, it's a fairly big application. And we thought about moving to SPA, single page application. So, it was not possible to move everything to SPA. So, certain sections were decided by the team. Architect started working on it. And then there was some POC done on the major complex area, and then it was rolled out across. But even today, that work took 1 year. Even today, both the flavors are supported. So there is a production ready code,
yeah,
which is there, and then there is an option to move to SPA mode to see how it is.
Okay.
So the preview also. So in order to support both these things through automation, it was important for us to invest.
Absolutely.
In such a way that we could solve both the problems, and so that was one of the reasons why there was a lot of investment done on the automation side.
Makes sense, and clearly it seems the team and management believes in the value automation is providing.
Yeah, it
otherwise it would never happen.
It was impossible to amount of manual test cases using SPA.
Exactly.
It was absolutely impossible. So it has become that reason why.
So from a framework perspective also, you need to give the business impact of not getting certain things done. Otherwise, again, it's a matter of prioritization. Business doesn't care about tests necessarily. Why would they care about tests? They're worried about features and how users are using those features. But the test is a means to enable doing that quicker and with confidence. And you have to highlight that aspect well.
Are you going to cover the aspect where, like, how much speed up the test? Like, if I have 1000 tests, it takes me 3 hours to get feedback. So, is there any way to, like, maybe parallelize it in like one simple case?
So, there are two quick options that come to mind. That parallelization is one. Second is delete tests, which don't make sense.
Delete tests?
Other than that, if it is adding value, then there's only so much you can parallelize and get done. Eventually, you have to wait for that time required. Oh, sorry, there's a third thing, right? I'm guessing you're talking all about UI functional tests.
Yeah.
Right? Exactly. So, how many of those 1000 tests can you move down to unit integration testing? That's option one. That's step one, not option one. Step one. Step two, run the tests in parallel as much as possible. As part of that, also there are many other things that are required to be done, right? Or can be done. Can you use APIs to set up data quickly instead of doing everything through the UI, those type of things. And third, again, is delete the redundant tests.
So how do we lay out this? How can we manage parallelization? Because the underlying, for example, the database is a shared, so the two tests are touching the same database. One is representing some data, other is expected. So how do you, is there any pattern or thing to manage? Like, you can't just spin up 10 machines and run tests on.
Correct. The whole ecosystem has to be set up.
Yeah, there's some dependency and stuff. Okay. Is there any,
so this is more in terms of data management and overriding or conflicting based on shared resources when running tests in parallel. We'll cover some aspects of that later on when we talk about test data itself. But otherwise we can have a separate conversation.
So
okay.
This conversation
brings one question to my mind. How to manage test independence? Setups and tables. So test independence, if you run the same test with different data in parallel, is it going to work correctly or not?
No,
it comes down to that one
question. I have seen frameworks where to accomplish one functionality, I have to first do something. That way I'm talking about test independence.
Linking test cases essentially.
Yeah.
I think that's a horrible way to do it. That's not a test essentially, right? The minute you have dependencies in tests, you'd rather put everything in one test itself and run it as one test. It's not adding value. But again, that's probably a little separate conversation that we can. So coming back to the main question, are there any limitations of the project pattern?
It can be abused, they said, like, an object-oriented language like C++ can be used to code like, procedural language also. So that way, page object model is a guideline approach, but if you have not designed it well, you may end up having less value.
Sure, but again, that's not a limitation of page object pattern. The way she said about complexity of a page object, it comes down to people working on it to make sure complexity is kept on refactored or put into different aspects to reduce it, right? Or make the design better. It's not really a problem of the page object pattern in that sense.
So driver is at a time a driver can hold a single page. In the technical term, you can say a driver will be pointing to a single page at a time. So until we navigate from that page, the driver.
What do you mean by the driver?
The instance of a driver.
The instance of a driver which points to instance of a browser. Driver knows nothing about the page.
Exactly.
Driver knows about instructions. What JavaScript do I need to inject to make that functionality work in the browser or not?
But it holds a single page at a time in the page object model.
It holds the instance of the browser it is talking to. It knows nothing about the page.
Right, but the current, it's until you navigate from that page, it cannot connect with the next page. Right? It's at a time under this holding the browser instance. But from what page is rendered currently, is what your driver can communicate with.
Again, driver doesn't know about, the reason I'm keeping on saying the same thing, driver knows nothing about the page. You are telling it, give me the registered patient ID, the newly created patient ID from the page. If you are not on that page, it is going to say, it's not found.
Right. Yeah.
It knows nothing about the page. I've been given instructions to do action or get information from the page. That is all it is. Which brings me to a different aspect again than this is what I have
to talk about.
Page objects are dummy objects.
They have no business logic in them. They have no inference or way to infer what is supposed to happen out of it. Other than certain aspects that you are explicitly saying in terms of form handling or whatever, right? Or waiting for certain events to happen, which is actual page logic in that sense, right? in terms of certain things being enabled, not, or that kind of thing. But otherwise, a login page has no idea should I be returning successful or not. It can just say, am I successful or not? Someone else take a decision, is that the right thing or not? Likewise, if I'm not on the page where I need to be, the page doesn't know anything about it, the driver object doesn't know anything about it, is the test intent which is driving the behavior needs to know, am I doing the right thing or not? That's where the assertions come into picture. Okay? That brings me to the other point which I'll just get covered, right? Where do assertions belong in your test framework?
In the test itself.
Okay? Anyone puts assertions in page objects? It's okay to say yes if you are. Have you seen assertions in page objects?
I have actually come across a design wherein we use assertions at the page object level, and then, but what we were doing there is we were using the test result page and then calling true or false the boolean value of test result on the test website. So that is how we were validating. So that was an extra level of abstraction actually.
Okay. In my opinion, assertions should never be in the page objects because they are dummy objects, they don't know what is right or wrong. The only thing right or wrong that they will know is if I'm supposed to enter address line 1 and that field is not there, it will say object not found. But if the reference has changed, it will throw a stale element exception or timeout exception, whatever that really means, right? Page objects work directly with the driver object to do actions and get information. No business logic over there, which means no assertions at that point. The test knows if I've given invalid credentials, I know login should have failed. I'm going to ask the login page, am I logged in? It will return me true or false. Based on that, it will do an assertion. If I gave it wrong data, then it should have returned me false. If I gave it correct data, it should have returned me true. That's where assertions came to. So keep that in mind again, that's very important. Again, coming back to our main question. Can you think of anything now as limitation? Because there clearly are.
Probably that page object is, if we are too focused on the pages and basically so we are coupled too much to the structure of the website itself, if it changes, then we might need to do a lot of restructuring about that.
Excellent. The comment was that page objects, or rather if you use, rely completely on page objects, your test intent is very coupled with the page objects, and as a result as well, it means you're completely tied to the design of the pages, the product itself, right? Any changes means again you have to come and change the functionality or the implementation of the page. And that's what I call as test intent gets polluted. My intent is, if I take a banking website, okay, if I'm working on a banking website product, if my intent is I should be able to transfer money from my savings to my loan account, for example, what are the actions that I need to do? I need to log in. And of course, there's a test data setup that is required that is separate, right? I need to have the user credentials, I need to have two accounts created for me, and balance in at least one that I'm going to transfer from the other. That's a prerequisite before running the test in some fashion. But the intent is going to be I have to, in terms of how the test itself would flow, right? Page objects. So login page dot login with valid credentials, for example. As a result, I'll get the home page. Logged in home page, right? From there, I'm going to say transfer money between accounts. From there, I will select source, destination, amount. Then there will be a confirmation page from where I'll again confirm and then say submit. And then I will verify transaction successful. I'll go back to both of my accounts one by one and ensure the amount is correctly debited, credited. Does that seem like a logical transfer money case scenario? Happy path scenario? I spoke about at least 6-7 different steps over here. They are not necessarily going to be just 6-7 different lines in your JUnit test. Now, there will be, how many combinations can you think of when you're thinking about transfer money case?
least 10-15 probably, right? Less money, more money, whatever, based on different data setup, of course, right? But the flow is still the same from the product perspective. And it's a very critical aspect. If it was my account, I better make sure everything else is going to be working correctly, right? So in all these different combinations, I have to keep on doing the same 7-8 different actions. Maybe data changing, maybe some methods changing here or there. Now if I have got 10 different tests in one class file related with transfer money, how do I exactly know, looking at that test, which test is doing what? Because nowhere am I able to really understand unless I get to each level of details in the test implementation, what exactly this test is doing. One might say, no, I have my test named correctly. Happy path scenarios, or low balance test, or transfer money test, whatever, right? How many times do we go back and update the test names or documentation that we might have written based on certain understanding? It's a classic problem, right? How much you can really do at every point in time. And that's the reason I said the test intent gets polluted as you keep on adding more and more tests, which are going to be very closely associated with each other. That is one problem. The second is duplication of the test intent and implementation. Now the first four steps out of all of these scenarios about transfer money is the same. The next set of actions is going to be different. But now I have repeated those same four lines in each of my tests. And repeating four lines is not as big a deal compared to when you have to go and change it and remembering to change it all in all the places. Again, the concept of drag, so we mentioned that, right? The reducing duplication of code. And that also becomes a problem as the framework grows. It is okay if we have got 4 scenarios or 10 scenarios or maybe up to 100 scenarios also, maybe it is manageable. But the minute that complexity grows, the minute the team members looking at that code base grows and working on the code base grows, it becomes a nightmare to me. And that is another problem. The intent also becomes imperative. Now I'm talking about page-based actions, right? I'm not talking about the business rules. I'm talking about which page do I need to do what actions, interactions, get what information to do assertions. It's not necessarily talking about my business rules that is really the case, which is what is required. As a result, there are maintenance challenges and there are scaling challenges. Can everyone relate to these challenges? It's okay if you've got less tests, then it is manageable. The minute that complex in the code base grows, then the challenges start coming.
Now I have a common theme to ask around this.
Yes.
So quite a few of the limitations that I see here, they are what about the intent of the developers or the engineers who are working around that test framework. So that means that they are not maintaining that. If they look at the code framework, actually the developer code that they are delivering, they keep on refactoring that, but once they move to the test framework, it's more about just get the job done and move your card. That is how the thinking is, and that's where these limitations come up, at least the first three.
There will be more such cases than just what you mentioned. That is still avoidable with good practices and regular conversations with the team. The same thing like having too much complexity in your page object, right? If there are good practices in the team, good knowledge sharing, discussions happening, you can keep on avoiding those kind of things. But if the scenarios, again, by scenarios I'm explicitly making sure I'm not calling it test cases, because scenarios are really end-to-end journeys. When you talk about the functional UI tests, they should be maximum end-to-end journeys, basic journeys that are there, and not specific cases that
exactly,
are
exactly, that is what I wanted to come up to, that
yes.
Team should be following the test pyramid and not be writing too many tests.
Exactly, and that is one of the solutions to reduce the complexity.
Right.
That is what I mentioned to him. Can you delete as many as you can safely by moving it down in the pyramid?
Right.
So, I was just kind of playing the revision, but say in this bank transactions of lending, like, is there really a need to write end-to-end tests for like bank transfer for all of them? Can we not move it down the stack?
It depends on the problem. See, eventually,
there may be one positive case, one negative case.
Exactly, and that's the right thing, right? So, 4 scenarios. He mentioned he's got 4 scenarios. Why does he have only 4? I don't know anything about his product. But I'm assuming he's got a good level of unit integration test. That's why he can live with just 4 scenarios on the problem.
And in that, you don't need any of these complexities. It's not going to become that complex. This complexity is okay to take on as intentional tech debt instead of making a big framework out of it. Because if I'm going to have 4, 10 tests, it's manageable, it's okay, I can live with it. If it has to grow to 1,000, 3,000, 4,000 tests, I better make sure I've got better practices in the implementation.
Sorry, sir. If you're starting out a new product and you have all those values and all that you follow trying for that, then you will end up following, at least trying to follow that test. That's it. If you're working on a legacy or if you've inherited a product, okay, this is the working product, now you have to maintain it. And if I have to make changes, I probably will start with the top level test than the unit level test. Writing unit test in those like existing code could be difficult.
Yeah. So very well said, and I completely agree. Before we get to the next thing, right, I want to give another example which I think really makes a lot of sense about the over-engineering aspect that we said, right? I showed the home page first. And we spoke about we use page object pattern, the code organization and everything. That is not necessarily wrong. Based on experience, we know we will need to do these kind of things anyway, based on what the objective is going to be. But I always correlate that with the case of, let's say, building a bridge across a valley or across a river. You have to know what you're getting into. You have to know what your objectives are. Based on that, you would think about what type of plan I need to create. Before doing that, I need to do some ground study. Is it a brown sand or it's hard rock bottom, whatever that might be. What type of bridge do I need? Is it a suspension bridge? Is it what other type of bridge that might be there? Is it a single lane? Is it a 10 lane bridge? What is going on? The requirements have to be clear. And then there's a beautification aspect to it as well, right? It should look aesthetically good as well. So all that thought process goes in before the architects come up with the plan of this is how the bridge is going to be. Based on that, what is the first thing that you do? You start ordering the light poles and everything that is required on the bridge. Because we start at the foundation. You start with the basics. And as things go on, you keep on evolving and saying, okay, now my foundation is done. Now I can do three different things in parallel. I can start with the pillars on two different sides maybe at the same time. When I have pillars on two sides done, why the other pillars are coming out, I can start doing some three other activities in parallel at the same time. Right? It's an evolution. You have to know what is your big picture, what is your end goal. So if you're starting off on a new product, implementation completely from scratch, if you know your end goal is you're going to follow these practices in place, the test pyramid has to be there in place, CI, CD, everything has to be there. Then you can say, okay, just less code at the top is going to be my approach. I don't need to over-engineer. But if, as you correctly said, if it's a legacy code or whatever, then you have to start with a different approach. So knowing your end goal is very important, but building a stepping stone approach towards that end goal is extremely critical. Otherwise, you end up unnecessarily over-engineering. I have seen so many cases where, oh, this is a product, Amazon, I need to automate. I'll identify all the pages, I'll write some scripts or whatever, I'll create all the 100 page objects required for it with all the 80 locations on them. Whereas I just need to use 5 out of those 80 pages. Right? Classic case of over-engineering. Context perspective is very important. That's why we started off with good. I think you joined slightly late, right? So good is relative to the context of what you're doing and what is required.
So the first implication you mentioned that the test intent gets pointed or we have a lot of methods which we don't know later that what is that method is. And just the method leaving also doesn't help. So how do we work on that?
And we'll be getting into that. The question over here before we proceed is, do you understand what we mean by test intent gets polluted? Do we have some clarity around what that potentially means? If that is the case, then we can proceed
Probably the apart from the first one, I think a part of the rest of them is more like because of the granularity of the page object itself.
And as a result in the test intent.
Yeah.
As a result.
Basically there is something that is missing. So you have page object, but what if your scenario is let's say constructed of 10 page objects? and then you need to come up with multiple of those kind of scenarios, then there is something missing in between, and you might end up doing lots of duplication of similar things on those
pages. Exactly. Yeah. And the other thing, other example that we had, right? Do I need to have an enter first name, enter last name, enter and line one? Or can I say enter personal information, enter address one information, enter address two information? So it's around 20 lines, you've got it into 3 lines, just passing in the relevant data objects, and it is very clear what type of patient am I creating.
Maybe like just to extrapolate, can we then take page objects to another level and instead of saying page objects, maybe functionality objects or something like that?
That's what we are getting into this. That is what we are getting. So again, if it is less number of tests, page objects works beautifully. And you don't have to over simplify or over complicate it. Based on the context, it works great. But the minute you start feeling you are spending too much time in debugging or spending too much time maintaining what is going on, or I don't know really what my tests are supposed to be doing anymore, because all I'm seeing is pages, 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 do this, page, do that. My intent of what I'm trying to achieve by these scenarios is getting lost. You need to take that step back, and then what we get into is what I like to call it a business layer page object pattern. In some cases, it might have been reported as flow-based page object pattern. Again, name does not matter. I like to think from a business layer perspective, because my tests, these scenarios are really business scenarios that I'm trying to evaluate and validate if it's working fine, because the rest of the tests in my pyramid are taking care of all other aspects of granular validations. Now this is just my last mile. Business scenario validation is what I'm going to do from here. Okay? That is what is a business layer page object pattern. So in terms of architecture, what does it look like? How does it evolve from the layer? And this is something exactly what you were referring to, right? My test intent is a pure intent. I'm going to transfer money from my savings to my checkings account or loan account, and this has to be a successful transaction. Of course, putting it in a proper business terminal. This is where BDD tools make it very obvious when you start thinking about this. Given I have sufficient balance in my savings account, when I transfer money to my loan account, then account details get updated with the relevant amount. Very specific business scenario. That is all my intent has at the top level. And I am by no means suggesting that everyone use BDD to do that, right? You can do the same thing in code as well. What is important to understand is that now you're separating your intent from your implementation. The orchestration which was happening in your JUnit test about working with all the page objects to orchestrate and do assertions over there, all that is moving to the next layer of business layer, whereas my intent remains, now I'm talking in business language. Patient creation, or patient, create patient as a business object, what can I do on that? On a registered patient, what can I do on that? It's not about one page or multiple. A business object can be cutting across n number of pages to accomplish that transaction, to accomplish that business. Okay, so now my intent, I've made it very precise. I've removed all references to pages from there. I've removed all assertions from the test as well, because business doesn't care about assertions. Business cares, are the business rules working correctly or not? The implementation of those business rules, which is this layer, is what is doing the orchestration across all the pages, doing all the assertions required over here. And the rest of the things remain absolutely the same. The pages have remained the same, the domain models, entities, resources, everything else has remained the same. You have just abstracted the orchestration of the pages and the rules associated with that over here. Give me a minute. Okay. Another very implicit thing that this does, right? Now my test as a JUnit test that I have potentially just has 3-4 lines over there, and those 3-4 lines can easily be understood compared to understanding the 10 pages and what exact operations I am calling on them. Okay, that becomes very important. As a result, because my test itself, the add test annotation based method in my class over there, any repeated code over there cannot really be shared unless you create private methods within the class, or you create another utility, another layer of sorts where these common methods will be called. That common utility or common place essentially is a business layer. You are just giving it not a common name per se, you are calling it based on the business domains that you really have. And we'll see some examples of that.
Yeah, so the way we have seen that in our case is that our assertions are still at the test intent level because we are not using BDD. There are two frameworks. The one which is not using BDD, the intent is, or assertions are still at the topmost layer. The orchestration between pages, synchronization, and other stuff is maintained in the business layer which you mentioned.
Yeah.
So is there any reason when you said that assertions you also moved into business?
So who's the audience of, there are multiple aspects to consider. Again, no right or wrong way. I've got reasons to believe where assertions need to be. Because I always think the intent of these scenario tests is to create reports and have business look at these reports to see what it really means. They have to get confidence in the type of testing that is going. Granular testing, it does not matter. But business needs to know, and they better know what we are doing because we want their input if something is missing over here. The classic loop, right? You get requirements, agile or not, doesn't matter. It gets it to implementation or the dev, test, and then prod. What is the feedback cycle of knowing the release criteria, is it working correctly or not? If you've got your CI/CD practices here, the team knows before taking the decision to go to prod, my granular implementation is correct. How does business work? The requirements came in, these types of tests are actually ensuring the requirements. Business is not telling I want a radio button or whatever, right? Business is saying I want to transfer money. That is what business intent. The test which is transferring money, they look at the report, they get assurance, yes, we are covering this aspect.
Yeah, got it.
Right? With that in mind, if the report has got a bunch of additional statements, assertions, they are going to get lost.
Yeah.
And more importantly, the test is still going to fail where it was supposed to fail. Just the point of failure is not in the business rule, it is going to be in the intent. It is going to map into a specific business rule, which is going to map into a specific page anyway. The business rule implementation has got assertions, the test does not have assertions. Login, if I consider as a business rule, the business rule of login successfully knows, should I be successful or not?
Login is a very basic example in this context of business rule.